Hey!
Ow!
Thanks for sticking it out this long. I'm the last one before lunch, so rest your empty stomachs and know that I'll make this as quick as possible. Cohort 7 is pretty familiar with Dead West. It's a concept that I've been tossing around since before I came to FIEA, but it's something that's developed a lot based on the feedback and input of everyone in this room who, you know, has been kind enough to talk to me about it. Dead West, as you can see, is a action RPG and tower defense hybrid set in a traveling carnival of carnage. I know that's overdone, but... Essentially, what we're really going for, and you're going to see a lot of clowns, a lot of circus performers, and I don't want that to override the fact that this is really supposed to be a creepy game. You're supposed to feel overwhelmed. It's tower defense, it's an action RPG, and it's played in the Diablo perspective, the isometric perspective. It's a lot of hack and slash. That's the core of your gameplay. But at the same time, you have to balance this with the aspect of placing defenses in real time while you're also defeating hordes of enemies. You will not be able to do them both 100%. You're going to have to balance that act, and you're not going to be able to win without doing both well. Like I said, it's in the Carnival Heading West. It's set in the 1880s, so this is the dying of the Old West. And when I say we're moving from the east to the west, we're going to get a variety of environments here. But really, we're starting about St. Louis and heading west from there. Nobody wants to play Dead West in, you know, New York City. A relic is stolen, a curse is unleashed. I have a backstory for all of this, but I want to stress that this is all a framework, obviously. If a team picks this up, it's all yours, it's your baby, and you can do whatever you want with it. The relic is actually an ancient evil that came across the Beringia, the land bridge from Siberia, about 15 to 20,000 years ago. And it's been supplanted in Native American myth and lore to the point where it's sort of been lost in that myth. There are stories about it, but no one really knows much about it. And a would-be, a former fugitive from England steals, who's become a circus worker and a traveling circus, steals this artifact from a curio collection and unleashes a horrible curse that overruns most of the circus. The performers return with an unholy drive to overwhelm the survivors and claim the remaining artifacts. The goal is to survive every single night. Waves after waves of enemies come through, and you pack up your camp and move to the next location. So I've described this a bit. You're battling waves of enemies from dusk till dawn. You're going to level your hero and defenses as you go along. There will be fat loot. I know some of you were afraid there wouldn't be fat loot. A lot of it is this addictive hack and slash kind of gameplay where you're going to be rocking stuff and tearing it apart. Of course, in this game, it's more like shoot and smash, not hack and slash. But, you know, they're loot pinatas. Things are going to pop out of the ground in pretty colors. People are going to feel addicted by that and keep playing. And you're going to get more powerful as time goes on. We have, like I said, you have to use tower defense to stop the horde. You can't just hack and slash. You're going to have to balance defenses, like maybe you'll put up a net gun over here or some barbed wire over there. You're doing that while you're fighting enemies. Certain enemies are going to be only defeatable by a hero character, and certain enemies are going to require the sort of comprehensive defense that setting up a defense of towers, and in this case wagons and that sort of thing, is going to provide you. Players must defend the wagon circle, which is the center of the map, and I'll get to that more in a little bit, from a bunch of enemies. And the waves of enemies are made up of circus freaks, geeks, clowns. I have to remind people that the original definition of a geek is somebody that bites the heads off of chickens for entertainment. So when you're calling yourselves geeks proudly, you might want to reconsider that. Again, this is done in real time, so none of this is like, you don't pause the game and lay down defenses. You have to balance these things. Heroes will use skills, abilities, inventory items, skill trees, gear, and pet and customization options. I want these characters to be customizable. There are three main characters that we're going to talk about, but they really sort of play out as classes in this game. And you will level them up with armor and weapons and that sort of thing specific to their class. These are the three heroes. Well, you only see two of them on the screen. Jack Deadeye Dixon is a gunslinger. Again, as a framework, but I have backstories for each of these people. They are three intimate stories that play into a larger world story about this curse and about escaping, but they all have their own reasons for wanting to go that way. Jack is the gunslinger. He's your classic cowboy. He's what makes the West, really, when you think about it. He will be able to, he'll be the ranged class. He has a lasso too, but most of what he's going to be doing is going to be playing like an archer class. He'll be staying back and shooting everything. Sora the Mystic is more of a thief class. Her focus is on mobility and sort of utility tools to get around and fight the enemies. She focuses on speed. And she's a gypsy. She was a con woman before this happened, and then when the curse was unleashed, she sort of gained some real power that is scaring her as much as it is helping her to get along. And then finally, the strong man, Joseph Tomahay. Tomahay was a famous Sioux Indian, and that's the namesake for this character. He is actually raised in the carnival, and he is very loyal to the carnival's owner, who's gone missing as part of this whole thing. And he's the strong man. He's going to play the basic melee class. He'll be up in your face, smashing things, wielding two-handed hammers, and that sort of thing. So this is a blending of genres and a blending of themes. So we're blending tower defense and action RPG, but we're also blending the West with the carnival and with this creepy undead thing. So here's a little bit on why I chose the West and what I think about when I talk about the West. This is from Ken Berg's special, The West. It's very brief, all in brief, if you will. Apparently they're going to make me exit the slideshow to do it. No, I don't want to upgrade.
It is what people who have come here from the beginning of time have dreamed. It's a dream landscape. To the Native American, it's full of sacred realities, powerful things. It's a landscape that has to be seen to be believed. And I say on occasion, it may have to be believed in order to be seen.
The Americans tell stories about themselves. They said those stories in once. The American heroes are Western heroes. When you begin to think of the quintessential American characters, they're always someplace over the horizon. There's always someplace in the West where something wonderful is about to happen. It's not what has happened, it's something wonderful is about to happen. And even when we turn that around, even when we say, well, something has been lost, what's lost is always in the West.
Of the 19th and 20th centuries. this is Billy No Mates. He is our main antagonist. He is a he's a former rodeo clown, a former dock worker, a fugitive from England, who really just was trying to get away from his past. And it's here that he found Dr. Ned Carver's cardinal and found a way to make himself what he thought more powerful, more rich. He finds this artifact. The other thing about the West is that it's infused with Native American archaeology and history, and that myth is sort of woven into this story. Like I said, that relic comes from the other side of the earth, but it's been woven into Native American folklore. The enemies have different motivations and that sort of thing. I'll get into that a little more in a bit. Okay, we're going to talk about artificial intelligence now. Not only do the enemies going to have different motivations, there are different types of enemies that require different strategies to defeat, but we were talking about something that rhymes with the Schmei Schmermechter. That would be Valve's patented, I mean, our patented AI procedural generator for creating intense moments. Essentially, since we have this horror mechanic, why can't our programmers come up with a way to create exciting moments when maybe the gameplay is lagging behind a little bit? Well, much like what's been done in Left 4 Dead. Smart enemies will do more than just charge and attack. They have different abilities. Some of them are going to go for your hero character, some of them are going to go for your defenses, and some of them are going to go right for the center of that camp, which is their ultimate goal. And if you can see, this is sort of the creepiness that we're going for here. And this is a boss character, thank you, Gary, who is basically a lion tamer that's been touched by the curse. Now, you can imagine a boss that you'd have to fight that would have a curse lions with her, and she'd have her own abilities, and there are a variety of strategies that go into tackling that. So we're going to go into the map layout a little bit. Some people have said this was hard to visualize, so I went into the old StarCraft 2 editor and whipped up some pretty, just some basic maps to show you what a layout might look like. You'll have a carnival circle, or this wagon circle, sort of at the center of the camp, and that's where you set up your defenses initially, and it's where you'll keep protecting the whole game. Enemies will come from basically all sides. An early map might have you in a pretty defensible position. There's no way you can be flanked here really all that easily. But you're still going to have to set up your defenses along these zones. And then maybe there's an area down here where there's a side quest, an optional quest. If you can find a way to break out from the hordes attacking, you can explore more of those options. Let's take a little closer view. The yellow box sort of represents what your viewer's area would be like, the player's area. And if you can imagine that Thor there in the middle is your character, and these are some of your defenses set up around the circle, and that little idol there is your treasure chest that you have to protect, the artifact wagon, as you were. It looks pretty simple now. I mean, you're basically going to get a trickle of enemies. The first wave comes through, it's pretty easy. You know, you shoot a few of them, they die, everything's good. But in Dead West, things get real bad real quick. If you've ever played StarCraft 2, you know this is not a good situation to be in. There's a lot of ultralisks there. So eventually you're going to have to get in there and start hacking and slashing, or, you know, because I had to work on the StarCraft 2 engine, burning things. But that's not enough. You also need, there are just too many of them to handle by yourself. You also need to set up defenses around sensor towers. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe not Middle West, but there will definitely be defenses that you set up and help you defeat waves and waves of enemies. And here's just another example of a Dead West style map. So maybe later, where you're in sort of an icy barrens. You know, the West has just a huge range of environments you can play with, including the snowy passes of the Sierra Nevadas, the fruited plains, whatever. But this is a map style that would be a lot harder to defend, because you've got four directions that enemies can come from. And of course, boss fights are always possible there too. So to summarize, I think this is the appropriate scope for FIEA. This is a really tough thing, and we have, you know, in the industry, it's really hard to get together a game in 6 months. At FIEA, it's even harder. We're a very small group of people, and we have other projects to work on, and we're going to be, you know, really focused on these things, but we want it to be something we can spiral outward. So we can put assets in one map and spiral it out to a point that we feel comfortable with before we start adding more assets. And as availability comes, you know, artists become available, as programmers become available from their previous tasks, we can move on to building that world out a little more and keep expanding on that as long as we have time to do it. It's a unique setting. It's Western and Carnival themes put together. I've never seen an action RPG in this setting. I think it would be fun. I think the gameplay speaks for itself. It's not a really hard concept to grasp in terms of gameplay, because These are definable things. When people get in and they start hacking and slashing, they'll immediately know, yeah, I've played this before. This is fun. Variant AI I've talked about, they have various ideas, goals, and concerns and strategies used to defeat them. There's a flexible backstory, and there's a known quantity. It's analogous to games we see in the industry now, although we don't see a lot of tower defense, action RPG hybrids. Both of those are very, you know, prominent in the industry right now. And that's what I have for you. That's Dead West.
Hey,
thanks for sticking it out this long. I'm the last one before lunch, so rest your empty stomachs and know that I'll make this as quick as possible. Cohort 7 is pretty familiar with Dead West. It's a concept that I've been tossing around just before I came to FIEA, but it's something that's developed a lot based on the feedback and input of everyone in this room who, you know, has been kind enough to talk to me about it. Dead West, as you can see, is a action RPG and tower defense hybrid set in a traveling carnival of carnage. I know that's overdone, but... Essentially, what we're really going for, and you're going to see a lot of clowns, a lot of circus performers, and I don't want that to override the fact that this is really supposed to be a creepy game. You're supposed to feel overwhelmed. It's tower defense, it's action RPG, and it's played in the Diablo perspective, the isometric perspective. It's a lot of hack and slash. That's the core of your gameplay. But at the same time, you have to balance this with the aspect of placing defenses in real time while you're also defeating hordes of enemies. You will not be able to do them both 100%. You're going to have to balance that act, and you're not going to be able to win without doing both well. Like I said, it's in the carnival heading west. It's set in the 1880s, so this is the dying of the old west. And when I say we're moving from the east to the west, we're going to get a variety of environments here. But really, we're starting about St. Louis and heading west from there. I mean, nobody wants to play Dead West in, you know, New York City. A relic is stolen, a curse is unleashed. I have a backstory for all of this, but I want to stress that this is all a framework, obviously. If a team picks this up, it's all yours, it's your baby, and you can do whatever you want with it. The relic is actually an ancient evil that came across the Beringia, the land bridge from Siberia, about 15 to 20,000 years ago. And it's been supplanted in Native American myth and lore to the point where it's sort of been lost in that myth. There are stories about it, but no one really knows much about it. And a former fugitive from England steals, who has become a circus worker and a traveling circus, steals this artifact from a curio collection and unleashes a horrible curse that overruns most of the circus. The performers return with an unholy drive that overwhelms survivors and claim the remaining artifacts. The goal is to survive every single night. Waves after waves of enemies come through, and you pack up your camp and you move to the next location. So I've described this a bit. You're battling waves of enemies from dusk till dawn. You're going to level your hero and defenses as you go along. There will be fat loot. I know some of you were afraid there wouldn't be fat loot. A lot of it is this addictive hack and slash kind of gameplay where you're going to be rocking stuff and tearing it apart. Of course, in this game, it's more like shoot and smash, not hack and slash. But you know, they're loot pinatas. Things are going to pop out of the ground in pretty colors. People are going to feel addicted by that and keep playing. And you're going to get more powerful as time goes on. We have, like I said, you have to use tower defense to stop the horde. You can't just hack and slash. You're going to have to balance defenses, like maybe you'll put up a net gun over here or some barbed wire over there. You're doing that while you're fighting enemies. Certain enemies are going to be only defeatable by a hero character, and certain enemies are going to require the sort of comprehensive defense, the setting up a defensive towers, and in this case wagons and that sort of thing is going to provide you. Players must defend wagon circle, which is the center of the map, and I'll get to that more in a little bit, from a bunch of enemies. And the waves of enemies are made up of circus freaks, geeks, clowns. I have to remind people that the original definition of a geek is somebody that bites the heads off of chickens for entertainment. So when you're calling yourselves geeks proudly, you might want to reconsider that. Again, this is done in real time, so none of this is like you don't pause the game and lay down defenses. You have to balance these things. Heroes will use skills, abilities, inventory items, skill trees, gear, and pet and customization options. I want these characters to be customizable. There are three main characters that we're going to talk about, but they really sort of play out as classes in this game. And you will level them up with armor and weapons and that sort of thing, specific to their class. These are the three heroes. Well, you only see two of them on the screen. Jack Deadeye Dixon is a gunslinger. Again, as a framework, but I have backstories for each of these people. There are three intimate stories that play into a larger world story about this curse, about escaping, but they all have their own reasons for wanting to go that way. Jack is the gunslinger. He's your classic cowboy. He's what makes the West, really, when you think about it. He will be able to, he'll be the ranged class. He has a lasso too, but most of what he's going to be doing is going to be playing like an archer class. He'll be staying back and shooting everything. Sura the Mystic is more of a thief class. Her focus is on mobility and sort of utility tools to get around and fight the enemies. She focuses on speed. And she's a gypsy. She was a con woman before this happened, and then when the curse was unleashed, she sort of gained some real power that is scaring her as much as it is helping her to get along. And then finally, the strong man, Joseph Tomahay. Tomahay was a famous Sioux Indian, and that's the namesake for this character. He is actually raised in the carnival, and he is very loyal to the carnival's owner, who's gone missing as part of this whole thing. And he's the strong man. He's going to play the basic melee class. He'll be up in your face, smashing things, wielding two-handed hammers, and that sort of thing. So, this is a blending of genres and a blending of themes. So we're blending tower defense and action RPG, but we're also blending the West with the carnival and with this creepy undead thing. So here's a little bit on why I chose the West and what I think about when I talk about the West. This is from Ken Berg's special, The West. It's very brief, all for you if you want. Apparently they're going to make me exit the slideshow to do it. No, I don't want to upgrade.
It is what people who have come here from the beginning of time have dreamed. It's a dream landscape. To the Native American, it's full of sacred realities, powerful things. It's a landscape that has to be seen to be believed. And I say on occasion, it may have to be believed in order to be seen.
Americans tell stories about themselves. They said those stories at once. The American heroes are Western heroes. When you begin to think of the quintessential American characters, they're always someplace over the horizon. There's always someplace in the West where something wonderful is about to happen. It's not what has happened, it's something wonderful is about to happen. And even when we turn that around, even when we say, well, something has been lost, what's lost is always in the West.
But what makes it great for this game is that it it's somewhere that we don't explore a lot, okay? We've had a few games recently that have, but never in this format. And when we talk about setting a story somewhere, I want it to be a place where the environment itself sort of takes its own meaning. And that brings us to the next part, which is to say that there's another genre we're blending in here, and that is the carnival performance and the circus culture. It's almost dead in America today, but everyone you see up here is a unique part of American culture that's dying. And they're also the stage and the setting for our enemies. They are the freaks and the geeks and the losers and the people that would have had no other place but were for the circuses of the 19th and 20th centuries. So this is Billy No Mates. He is our main antagonist. He is a former rodeo clown, a former dock worker, a fugitive from England, who really just was trying to get away from his past. And it's here that he found Dr. Ned Carver's carnival and found a way to make himself what he thought more powerful, more rich. He finds this artifact. The other thing about the West is that it's infused with Native American archaeology and history, and that myth is sort of woven into this story. Like I said, that relic comes from the other side of the earth, but it's been woven into Native American folklore. The enemies have different motivations and that sort of thing. I'll get into that a little more in a bit. Okay, we're going to talk about artificial intelligence now. Not only do the enemies going to have different motivations, there are different types of enemies that require different strategies to defeat, but we were talking about something that rhymes with the Shmei Shmermector. That would be our patented AI procedural generator for creating intense moments. Essentially, since we have this horde mechanic, why can't our programmers come up with a way to create exciting moments when maybe the gameplay is lagging behind a little bit? Well, much like what's been done in Left 4 Dead. Smart enemies will do more than just charge and attack. They have different abilities. Some of them are going to go for your hero character, some of them are going to go for your defenses, and some of them are going to go right for the center of that camp, which is their ultimate goal. And if you can see, this is sort of the creepiness that we're going for here. And this is a boss character, thank you, Gary, who is basically a lion tamer that's been touched by the curse. Now, you can imagine a boss that you'd have to fight that would have a curse lions with her, and she'd have her own abilities, and there are a variety of strategies that go into tackling that. So we're going to go into the map layout a little bit. Some people have said this was hard to visualize, so I went into the old StarCraft 2 editor and whipped up some pretty, just some basic maps to show you what a layout might look like. You'll have a carnival circle, or this wagon circle sort of at the center of the camp, and that's where you set up your defenses initially, and it's where you'll keep protecting the whole game. Enemies will come from basically all sides. An early map might have you in a pretty defensible position. There's no way you can be flanked here really all that easily. But you're still going to have to set up your defenses along these zones. And then maybe there's an area down here where there's a side quest, an optional quest. If you can find a way to break out from the hordes attacking, you can explore more of those options. Let's take a little closer view. The yellow box sort of represents what the viewer's area would be like, the player's area. And if you can imagine that Thor there in the middle is your character, and these are some of your defenses set up around the circle, and that little idol there is your treasure chest that you have to protect, the artifact wagon, as you were. It looks pretty simple now. I mean, you're basically going to get a trickle of enemies. The first wave comes through, it's pretty easy. You know, you shoot a few of them, they die, everything's good. But in Dead West, things get real bad real quick. If you've ever played StarCraft 2, you know this is not a good situation to be in. There's a lot of ultralisks there. So eventually you're going to have to get in there and start hacking and slashing, or, you know, because I had to work on the StarCraft 2 engine, burning things. But that's not enough. You also need, there are just too many of them to handle by yourself. You also need to set up defenses around the sensor towers. Well, maybe not Middle West, but there will definitely be defenses that you set up and help you defeat waves and waves of enemies. And here's just another example of a Dead West style map. It's maybe later where you're in sort of an icy barrens. You know, the West has a huge range of environments you can play with, including the snowy passes of the Sierra Nevadas, the fruited plains, whatever. But this is a map style that would be a lot harder to defend because you've got four directions that enemies can come from. And of course, boss fights are always possible there too. So to summarize, I think this is the appropriate scope for FIEA. This is a really tough tough thing. And we have, you know, there in the industry, it's really hard to put a get together engagement in 6 months. At FIEA, it's even harder. We're a very small group of people, and we have other projects to work on, and we're going to be, you know, really focused on these things, but we want it to be something we can spiral outward. So we can put assets in one map and spiral it out to a point that we feel comfortable with before we start adding more assets. And as availability comes, you know, artists become available, as programmers become available from their previous tasks, we can move on to building that world out a little more and keep expanding on that as long as we have time to do it. It's a unique setting. It's Western and Carnival themes put together. I've never seen an action RPG in this setting. I think it would be fun. I think the gameplay speaks for itself. It's not a really hard concept to grasp in terms of gameplay, because these are definable things. When people get in and they start hacking and slashing, they'll immediately know, yeah, I've played this before. This is fun. The Varian AI I've talked about, they have various ideas, goals, and concerns and strategies used to defeat them. There's a flexible backstory, and there's a known quantity. It's analogous to games we see in the industry now, although we don't see a lot of tower defense action RPG hybrids. Both of those are very, you know, prominent in the industry right now. And that's what I have for you. That's Dead West.